A sleepy town is plagued by a rabid dog, a terrifying vision of open-mouthed aggression, its saliva saturated with a contagion that could send the whole town into a spiral of fear. This image is horrifying, as the dog presents itself in a rabid frenzy, its teeth ready to sink into any flesh within reach. The culprit behind this uncommon madness is the rabies virus, a tiny but destructive RNA virus. The rabies virus doesn't exert its effects immediately. The disease progresses over the course of 1 to 2 months, an incubation period where the virus stealthily infiltrates its host. The initial symptoms are nonspecific, akin to a common flu with perhaps a prickling sensation at the site of the bite. The disease then progresses towards more debilitating symptoms, such as hyperactivity, aggression, and a fear of water or hydrophobia. The question is, what makes the rabies virus so potent and complex? Our forebears, such as the Greeks and Romans, also dealt with this disease, personifying its symptoms in their nomenclature. They named it Lyssa and rabies, echoing the Greek and Latin words for rage, respectively. They were no strangers to the insanity this disease inspired, yet they hadn't the means for treatment or a cure. The centuries rolled on until Louis Pasteur made his serendipitous entrance, developing a vaccine that continues to save countless lives. Rabies, typical of viruses, invades a host's cells and manipulates their machinery to replicate its own genetic material. The virus then proceeds to rupture the host cell to release multiple copies, which seek out new cells to corrupt. As the virus mounts its attack, the initial flu-like symptoms fall away. The disease begins to show its face once the virus reaches and infects the spinal cord and brain. As the brain cells succumb to this viral invasion, encephalitis sets in, which begins to warp the individual's mental and physical functioning. It is believed that the rabies virus hijacks specific serotonergic pathways that control aggression, though its precise mode of action remains shrouded in mystery. The virus also interferes with certain nicotinoid receptors located in the brain and muscles, causing muscle paralysis. A person will also begin to salivate excessively and become hydrophobic. The virus's affinity for salivary gland cells leads to this apparent hydrophobia, not due to an irrational fear of water, but because swallowing causes extreme pain. The virus manipulates the host to keep the mouth flooded with virus-rich saliva, thus improving its chances of transmission to new hosts. Our understanding of rabies is still in its infancy, although great strides have been made. We are aware that the virus invades cells and migrates to the brain, where it then wreaks havoc. Despite this knowledge, we still don't fully comprehend how rabies fundamentally alters its environment and which neuronal pathways it utilizes. A testament to our lack of understanding is the case of a high school girl who survived rabies without vaccination in 2011, challenging the belief of rabies' certain mortality once it reaches the brain. Her survival, attributed to a strategy now called the Milwaukee Protocol, reignited a spark of curiosity within the scientific community regarding this elusive disease. Was her survival due to the effectiveness of the protocol? Or could it be attributed to infection by a weakened strain of the rabies virus? As these questions remain unanswered, our journey to understand the mysteries of rabies continues.